Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nasta'dih. Wa na'udhu billahi ta'ala min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlil fala hadiya lahu. Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu. Wa ashhadu anna sayyidana wa habibana wa uswatana wa qaidana Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi al-tayyibin al-tahirin wa ashabihi ajma'in wa ala kulli man tabi'ahum bi ihsanin ila yawmiddin. Allahumma allimna ma yanfa'una wa anfa'na bima 'allamtana wa zidna 'ilma. Subhanaka Allahumma la 'ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana innaka antal 'alimul hakim. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna ittiba'ahu wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna ijtinabahu. Respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. If I can just ask the brothers to just slightly move ahead, inshallah. There's too much gap distance between myself and yourself. So, inshallah, it's fine for some of the brothers. If they want to come here, they can join us, inshallah. As the brother just introduced today's topic, al-Qur'an, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as he also mentioned, that I've been coming here a few times previously. I think I've been here at least four times previously giving talks. I also gave once a course, whole weekend course, Saturday and Sunday, from a book called Min Adab al-Islam. So this masjid is quite familiar. But one thing I see that every time I come, I see new faces, different faces. I don't see some old faces, and I see different new faces. So, alhamdulillah, it's good. I think people are moving in and out from this area. Allah knows best. But the topic, today's topic revolves around Qur'an. It's a very important topic, and I really want your attention, brothers and sisters. Qur'an being a cure, a shifa. Spiritual shifa, as well as a shifa for our societal problems, as well as Qur'an being a cure for physical ailments, maladies, and diseases, and illnesses, and sicknesses. These are three areas, and I want to talk about these three areas. This unique book, the Qur'an, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the kalamullah, the speech of Allah. This book, we need to sometimes think that this is such an amazing, unique book. It's an unparalleled book, unique book. And why wouldn't it be a unique book? Because they are the words of Allah. Imagine, these are the actual words, the statements, the words of our Lord and our Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Qur'an. The Qur'an has many different names given to it. The ulama have actually, the scholars have actually written books compiling and gathering the various names of this unique book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on the names that have been mentioned in the Qur'an itself. Al-Qur'an, which is also being called Al-Kitab. Alif, La, Mim, Dhalik Al-Kitab. La Rayba Fi. Al-Kitab. Allah talks about the Qur'an, describes it as being the book, Al-Kitab. It's also known as Al-Huda, guidance, Al-Furqan, that which differentiates between Al-Haq wal-Batil, the truth and falsehood. Al-Nur. It's also been called in the Qur'an, Al-Nur, the light, the message, Al-Dhikr. And numerous other names that have been given. Some of the ulama, as I said, they compiled books and they gathered the names of this book approximately totally to 90 odd names and even more to this unique book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A book which is unparalleled, unequaled, unchangeable. Very important point. It's unchangeable ila yawm al-qiyamah, until the day of judgment. No matter what people say or what they want to do and people want to interpret it in a different way, or change parts of it, or remove ayat and verses from the book of Allah. This book of Allah, it's until the final hour, until the day of judgment. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this as the final book from all the different books and scriptures that were sent. Remember, there were many scriptures, many, many small scriptures that were given to different anbiya and prophets. Suhufu Ibrahim wa Musa. Allah says, Suhuf Ibrahim wa Musa. The scriptures given to Ibrahim and Musa and many other prophets that were given small booklets and scriptures. And the four main books, at Tawrat, Zabur, Injil, and Quran is the final book on the final messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a unique book. We sometimes forget to realize how unique this book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Reason being, you know why? Because we see it every day. We see this book, we come into the masjid, it's there. You know, it's such a unique book. Imagine, you know, these are the words of Allah. But we don't, I'm not saying for everyone, but many of us, we do not appreciate this book of Allah. We don't totally value and appreciate the book of Allah. We don't really value it. The reason behind this is because we did not have to struggle. We never had to sacrifice. We never had to spend any wealth or any money, or we never underwent any difficulties and hardships in order to gain this book. The real true appreciation and value of this book, you know who has the true appreciation? The companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, may Allah be pleased with them all. Ask them the true value of the book of Allah, who went for every verse, for small verses of the book of Allah, they had to spend money, they had to give their lives in order to even acquire one single verse of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They sacrificed their wealth, their money, they underwent hardships and difficulties. For us, it's very easy. We were born, we see a book, it's there, you know, the different colors, blue, red, green, and that's it. It's gathering dust at home sometimes. We don't really appreciate and value this book. So the first point is that we really need to be, you know, we need to think and reflect on this point daily. These are the words of Allah. Just imagine if someone, you know, sends us a letter or a book, someone who's absolutely beloved to us. You know, some of the young people who are, you know, sometimes in love and in lust and whatever, you know, they have a, you know, a love letter sent to them by their beloved, they will evaluate and treasure it and appreciate it, and they'll keep it somewhere safe under the pillow, or I don't know where they'll keep it, to the point that, you know, some of these young people, you know, they even keep their text messages, you know, their girlfriend, boyfriend in a haram way, let's say in a halal way, husband, wife, mashallah, halal, love. You know, text messages full of love, you preserve it, you keep it safe, you don't even delete it. Imagine, these are the words of Allah, who is not a human. The words of Allah, you know these words, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Some of the early scholars would read and listen even one verse in their ear. They would fall unconscious onto the ground because of hearing these words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the words of Allah. And that's why we really need to value and appreciate this book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But as I was saying, what I want to really talk about is the Qur'an being a shifa, a cure, in three different areas. And I want to talk about briefly these three areas. And this is the reason we chose this topic. Qur'an being a shifa, a sense of cure, a means of cure. And Qur'an being a cure from, number one, spiritual diseases. The Qur'an being a spiritual cure. Number two, the Qur'an being a cure for the diseases and problems of the society. And number three, the Qur'an, the book of Allah, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being a cure for the diseases, the physical maladies and physical illnesses. So we want to talk about these three areas. And before I go on to talk about these three areas, the first two areas are the main two areas. First two areas, and I will focus my talk more on the first two areas, and maybe just talk briefly a few minutes on the final area, because primarily the book of Allah is a cure in a spiritual sense. And number two, it's a cure for the afat al-mujtama', the problems of the society. And number three, on the side, yes, okay, it's also a cure from physical ailments and physical diseases of the body. So let's look at these three areas. I mean, this is based around the verse of the Qur'an. The Qur'an itself tells us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself tells us that the Qur'an is a cure. A famous verse in the Qur'an that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Isra, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ. Verily we reveal the book. وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ. Now this min, for those who know Arabic, like the ulama Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah and many others say that this min in the bayan al-jins, it's not we reveal from the Qur'an, it's we reveal the Qur'an, not part of the Qur'an. فَإِنَّ الْقُرْآنَ كُلُّهُ شِفَى. Because Qur'an is a cure completely, not part of the Qur'an that are a means of cure for us, but rather the whole book of Allah. From surah, the beginning of Surah Al-Fatiha, from Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen to Min al-Jinnati wal-Nas. From the first verse to the last verse, completely. The book of Allah is a cure. So Allah says, وَنَزِّلْنَا Quran, we reveal the book to you. مَا هُوَ شِفَاء, which is a cure to you, cure for you. مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ, it is a cure and a sense and a source of rahmah and mercy for the believers. And in another place Allah says, وَلَوْ جَعَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا أَعْجَمِيًّا لَقَالُوا لَوْلَا فُصِّلَتْ آيَاتُهُ. Some of the, you know, the mushrikun, the Palestinians, they requested the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, why didn't Allah reveal this book in another language? Why in the Arabic language? So Allah said, had we revealed this book, if we had revealed جَعَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا عَجَمِيًّا in a non-Arabic language, لَقَالُوا, they would have had another problem with it. They would have said, لَوْلَا فُصْلَتْ آيَاتُ, why are the verses not clearly explained? لَوْلَا فُصْلَتْ آيَاتُ. And then they would say, أَعْجَمِيُّ وَعَرَبِي, the Prophet is an Arab and the book is in a non-Arabic language, it doesn't make sense to us. So Allah said, this is the reason why we sent and revealed the book in the Arabic language. And then after that Allah says, قُلْ, O Messenger, say to them, قُلْ هُوَ هُدًى وَشِفَاءٌ, this book is a source or a sense of, or a means of guidance, هُدًى وَشِفَاءٌ, and a cure. Another verse. And there are many other verses that talk about the Qur'an being shifa and cure. I just mentioned two verses to you. One is Surah Al-Isra and the other one is Surah Fussilat, where Allah talks about the Qur'an being shifa and a cure. And there are some other verses as well. Now, the three areas in which Qur'an is a cure and a shifa. The most important element of Qur'an being a cure and a shifa, the most important area is the first area. Qur'an is shifa'un lima fi sudur, cure for the diseases of the heart, cure for the diseases of the inner self. It's a spiritual cure. Qur'an is a cure in a spiritual sense, and that's the primary meaning of the Qur'an being shifa and a cure. Allah says this in the Qur'an, in Surah Yunus, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ, O mankind, humanity, O people, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ, verily to you has come مَوْعِظَةٌ. مَوْعِظَةٌ means nasiha, advice, guidance. To you has come the advice, Qur'an has been revealed to you. قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ, from your Lord. And then Allah says, وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ, and it is a shifa, this maw'idha, this guidance, this book, the Qur'an, it is a shifa, a cure, lima fi sudur, cure for that which is in the heart. That's the cure for the diseases of the inner self. Lima fi sudur, it's a spiritual cure, the Qur'an. In Hassan al-Basri, rahimahullah, one of the great scholars, as I said, the main understanding of the scholars is that Qur'an is mainly, primarily the cure for spiritual diseases, and that's why my focus will be more on that. And then number two and number three, Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah, he used to say, Qur'an is really, his opinion, his position, his understanding was, Al-Qur'an shifa'un lima fi sudur faqat. Only the Qur'an is only, when Allah talks about Qur'an being a cure, it is only in a spiritual sense. Anyway, that was his opinion. Majority of the scholars, their opinion is that no, Qur'an is a cure spiritually, physically, socially, all the problems that we find in our lives. But yes, primarily it is for, all the scholars agree on this fact that Qur'an is a cure primarily for the diseases of the heart. It's a spiritual cure. It's a cure for, spiritually. Now, how is this Qur'an, the book of Allah, a cure for us spiritually? We say we have the book of Allah. Is this Qur'an going to be a cure for us in a spiritual sense if we leave it in the masjid, in the house of Allah, within the, you know, the cupboards or in the cabinet? Will the Qur'an be a cure for us if it sits at home gathering dust? Is the Qur'an going to be a spiritual cure for us if we just pick it up in the month of Ramadan and just about read a few verses? Is the Qur'an will it be a cure for us if we just read it whenever we feel like it, when somebody maybe passes away and we do a khatam? No, the Qur'an will not be a spiritual cure with doing those things. Qur'an being a spiritual cure, we all know that we have to recite the book of Allah. And now this is what I'm going to explain to you. How can we make the book of Allah a spiritual cure for us? We know we have to recite the book of Allah. There are many rewards that have been promised in reciting Tilawatul Qur'an, reciting the words of Allah, reciting the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hadith in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, Sayyiduna Abu Umam al-Bahili radiallahu anhu relates, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Iqra'ul Qur'an, read the book of Allah, Iqra'ul Qur'an, فَإِنَّهُ يَأْتِي يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ شَفِيعًا لِأَصْحَابِهِ. Because this book of Allah on the Day of Judgment will appear and will come and intercede for the one who used to recite it. There's a hadith in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, الصيام والقرآن يشفعان للعبد يوم القيامة. Fasting and the Book of Allah, Quran, will both intercede for the slain on يوم القيامة. And then يقول الصيام, the fast will speak. Allah, our Lord and Creator, Allah Subhanahu wa Taala, will enable, will give fast an ability to speak. It's not far fetched. A lot of things that are not human speak nowadays. So Allah will give it, and it will enable fast a body to speak. And the fast will say, Ay Rabbi, O my Lord, manahtul ta'am. I prevented this slave of yours from eating. I stopped him from eating. He never ate food. Washahawat, and I prevented him from fulfilling his desires during the day. Fashafi'ni fihi. So accept my intercession for him. ويقول القرآن, and the Quran speak as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give Quran, the book of Allah, an ability to speak, and it will say, رَبِّي مَنَعْتُهُ النَّوْمِ, oh my Lord, I stopped him from sleeping in the middle of the night. بِاللَّيْلِ فَشَفِّعْنِي فِيهِ, so accept my intercession for him. فَيُشَفَّعَانِ, and both Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept the invitation of both the fast as well as the Quran. These are the two things to do during the day and night. And there are many other, you know, hadith of the Messenger of Allah that talk about recitation. خَيْرَكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ, the best of you are the ones who teach the Book of Allah and the ones who learn the Book of Allah. And there are many, many, many hadiths that talk about the virtues of reciting the Book of Allah. But brothers and sisters, that's not where we just get the spiritual cure. Spiritually, Qur'an being a spiritual cure for us, the Qur'an will only be a spiritual cure for us if we recite the Book of Allah in a manner that we are supposed to recite it. There is a way to recite it. There are etiquettes, there are rules, there are laws, there are regulations. There are adab and etiquettes for the recitation of this unique, amazing, unchangeable, unparalleled Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is a method of the recitation of the Book of Allah. If we observe these etiquettes, these laws and these rules, only then we will see that the Qur'an is a spiritual cure for us. Not just, you know, as I said, we pick the book up, you know, okay, read a few verses here and there. No. There's a way and method of reading the Book of Allah. The ulama have actually, the scholars, our salaf, early scholars have written books on the methods and the etiquettes and the rules of reciting the Book of Allah. Like for example, a few things I mentioned to you, al-taharatu wa al-nadhafa, being, you know, one of the etiquettes is a person being physically clean and pure when he recites the Book of Allah. He is pure, he is not in a dirty, filthy state, recommended to perform ablution, be in the state of wudu, in the state of purity. Some of the scholars used to say it's recommended to brush your mouth and clean your teeth, use the siwak before wanting to recite the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, giving it absolute importance. Because remember, this book is not like any other book. This is not Harry Potter that we just sit in our bed and, you know, like relaxed, you know, chill and read the book. These are the words of Allah. There is a way to sit and read as well. There is a method, there are rules and etiquettes, and this is something agreed upon. I'm not saying it's haram to read in any other way, but these are etiquettes. There are books written on this topic. Imam An-Nawawi radiallahu anhu, one of the great scholars, the jurist, and the great muhaddith of this ummah, the great Shafi'i scholar, he wrote a whole book in Arabic, which I believe has been translated into English, called At-Tibyan fi Adabi Hamalat al-Qur'an, the adab, the etiquettes in reciting the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these are some of the things that he mentioned, that cleanliness, purification, tahara and nadafa, and then selecting the right time, and selecting the right place to read the book and the right time. Az-zamanu wal-makan, there are etiquettes, right place, in an appropriate place, in a clean place. Masjid, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is a very good place to read the Book of Allah. Afdaluhu al-masjid. It's permissible everywhere else, even at home we should read, but it's good. Facing in the direction of the Qibla, That's another etiquette in terms of regarding the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also, time, we're looking at time. Sorry, that's the place. Makan. Clean place. Where you will not be disturbed. That's another etiquette. Not whether, you know, you're at home, the TV's on, and you know, you're reading the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or someone's on the internet and doing something and you're just out there reading, okay, yeah, what's going on? Check some of the sales tomorrow, Boxing Day, whatever. Go back, click that page you want. That's not the way to read the Book of Allah. In an isolated place where you are fully focused. And then the timing, when should we read the Book of Allah? Some of the ulama said it's highly encouraged. And this is based on the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to read it in the middle of the night. At night, reading the Book of Allah in Salatul Layl. And alhamdulillah, today you have this Qiyamul Layl. It's an amazing time, a tranquil time to read the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also, if you can't do Qiyamul Layl every day. We do it in Ramadan. You will have to go work in the morning, normally on normal days. It's difficult. If it's not possible at night, then you know what? The best time. And every one of us, every Muslim should have this habit. This is like a must for every Muslim. Allah says in the Quran, أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِدُلُوكِ الشَّمْسِ إِلَىٰ غَسَقِ اللَّيْلِ وَقُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ. That establish prayer, أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ, from afternoon when the sun starts moving, لِدُلُوكِ الشَّمْسِ إِلَىٰ غَسَقِ اللَّيْلِ, until nightfall, meaning offer prayers, ظَهَرْ عَصَرْ مَغْرِبْ عِشَىٰ. And then Allah says, وَقُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ, and the Qur'an which is recited in Salatul Fajr. Allah is really talking about the Fajr prayer, establish your Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, and Fajr. But to describe Fajr, he talked about Qur'an. He said, Qur'an al-Fajr. Because the Qur'an which is recited and heard in Salatul Fajr is probably the most effective for a believer. In prayer as well. That's the reason why it's recommended to have lengthy recitation in Salatul Fajr. طوال المفصل, more than other prayers. Reason being is because it's a tranquil time. It's a peaceful time. You've woken up just in the morning. We are fresh. It's slightly dark, slightly light in between day and night. It's not completely light. And it's not completely dark as well, not completely light. So Fajr time, وَقُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ كَانَ مَشْهُودًا. إِنَّ قُرْآنَ الْفَجْرِ كَانَ مَشْهُودًا. Allah says because the Qur'an that is recited at the time of Fajr, mashhood, it is well attended by the angels. The angels are well attending that recitation. And in Fajr prayer, and then after Fajr prayer, we should have this habit every day after Fajr prayer, whether at home, or whether in the masjid, or whether at home. Take out at least 15 minutes, if not more. If you can't take more than 15 minutes, then just take out 15 minutes of your special busy time and dedicate it exclusively for the words and for the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's an amazing time to read the Book of Allah. Those of you who have this habit, I don't have to tell you, you know yourself. It's extremely spiritually uplifting. In the morning, the spiritual nourishment of the soul that you can gain from reciting the Book of Allah in the morning, I believe you can't get that any other time during the day. It's just such a unique, tranquil time. And you know, it's just an amazing time for those who read in the morning, you know. So in the morning, try to read. It's a you know, very effective way of reading the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the times, the right place, right time. And then there are two very important parts. Two what we call ruknani azimah. Imam al-Nawawi called these two the main two integrals of the recitation of the Book of Allah. These are integrals. These are very important aspects when we recite the Book of Allah. One is tadabbur, and the other is tartib. First one, tartib. Very important, reading the Book of Allah with tartib. Tartib means not hasty. Slow, gradual recitation of the Book of Allah. Allah says in the Quran, وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا. Recite the book, which has the Quran, in a calm, measured manner. In a composed manner. Do not haste. وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا. Allah mentioned tartil twice. Emphasis, repetition. وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا. And this is an amr. Command. Allah says, وَرَتِّلْ صِغَةُ الْأَمَرْ. That you have to read the Book of Allah. Not in a hasty fashion. Ensuring every single letter. And every single word is uttered and pronounced in the most appropriate and the most correct of manners and ways, with proper observation of the rules of and the qawa'id of tajweed. It's very important, not just eating up the words. Sometimes, unfortunately, some of us don't even know how to read the Book of Allah. We've lived a life of 50, 60, 70 years, and we've had time for everything and all the degrees and everything we know about the world. One basic thing that we are not able to read a page correctly from this book, which is not written by any person on the road, not written by our friends or our parents. These are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with correct pronunciation. And it's unfortunate. Sometimes we see the people, you know, they recite the book, they are making huge mistakes in the recitation of the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam An-Nawawi says that all the ulama and scholars, they are united on the fact that it's actually makruh and dislike to haste in the recitation of the Book of Allah, whether in prayer or outside prayer. Even in prayer, the imam is, you know, instructed, and alhamdulillah, we heard some beautiful recitation today in Salatul Isha. That's the way we need to read. The imam has been instructed. Not just the Quran recitation, but even the whole prayer. With tamanina fi salah, i'tidal al-arkan. You know, you go to a masjid where you have, you know, good salah, you actually want to go and pray there. The imam is reciting the words of Allah in a very collective way, in a very calm manner, in a measured manner. The ruku' and the sujood and the qiyam is being done with tamanina, with i'tidal al-arkan, with calmness and composure. That is a must in prayer. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once saw a A'rabi, a villager who came, and he prayed so fast, he said to him, قُمْ فَصَلِّ فَإِنَّكَ لَمْ تُصَلِّ. Repeat and pray, because you haven't prayed three times. And then he explained to him how to offer the prayer. So, even in salah, we need to pray in a calm, composed manner. I don't know what the case is here is, but in some of our communities where people get frustrated and agitated in the month of Ramadan in Taraweeh, when the imam is reading slowly, even 10 minutes, we cannot give for the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People, and it's like a burden, 20 rak'ah. Most of the places they offer 20, which is, you know, sunnah way of reading. Most of them, what happens is, you know, they nudge them, 16, oh, brothers, how many left? Okay, 20, 14. Okay, how many left now? 16. Taraweeh salah, al-qiyam al-layl should be something that we want to do out of love. Not like a burden. Not a burden. It's something we should want to do for the sake of Allah. If we cannot complete the whole Quran because we get tired or whatever, there's no obligation. Yeah, it's sunnah, it's good, we should complete the whole recitation. But if we cannot, it's not wajib, it's not fard. It's not, you know, something that's obligatory, it's a sunnah. It's actually better to read and listen to less in a calm and composed manner than just haste and complete the Qur'an. It's not about quantity, it's about quality. When we recite, even in Ramadan, it's about quality. One page in a calm, composed manner is better than five pages where you say, it happens sometimes. It's like one breath, This is not the way to read the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So tartib, ma'a tabyin al-huruf wa makharij al-huruf. All the words, every single letter is pronounced and uttered in the correct manner that we have been ordered to do. This is a hukam, a command. Sighatul Amr. Warattil. Allah says, warattil al-Qur'an al-tartila. So that's the main integral. I said there are two main integrals. Number two, the second great integral of the recitation of the Book of Allah. We've talked about, you know, nadafa, purity, and choosing the right time, and we've talked about choosing the right place, and then we talked about slow, gradual recitation in a calm, measured manner. Now, the main integral is tadabbur. Tartil was one main integral. The other main aspect is tadabbur, reflection. And this is very important. Reciting the Book of Allah with thought, with reflection, with tafakkur and tadabbur, with understanding, with khushu', with concentration. Not that we're reading lines and lines and we don't know what we're reading, we're thinking about something else. We're thinking about the weather outside and we don't know where we're reading. When we started here and then we just realized that we've done four pages already. I mean, that's not what... That recitation of the Qur'an will not do us any benefit spiritually. If we want the Qur'an to be a spiritual benefit to us, then it's with tadabbur, with reflection. I'll say one thing here, that look, there is definitely reward in reciting a book of Allah even without understanding. That's also there. I mean, we have two extremes sometimes within the Muslims, where we have one extreme where people say that, you know, what's the benefit? You know, someone's reading a book, he's, for example, a non-Arab, he doesn't know the Arabic language, and he's just reading away. There's no benefit, you know, understand it, look at the translation, if you don't know, you know, if you... Remember, the book of Allah is not like any other book. Even those who understand it, we read time and time and time and again. You will never be bored from this book. Every time. It's not like any other book. There's no book on the face of the earth that you can read more than 3-4 times. Even your most favorite novel or whatever, after 6-7 times you get bored. You get totally bored from it. There's nothing in this world that you can repeatedly read it and recite it. It's the uniqueness and the mu'jizah, the miracle of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we can carry on reading it, yet we don't get bored. So this book of Allah, this one extreme, as I said, this one extreme we find within some people, that they think that if you don't understand, there's no reward. That's a wrong extreme. That's a wrong understanding, incorrect understanding. Allah says in the Quran, هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا من أنفسهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة. Allah is the one who sent His messenger. What are the basic objectives, maqasid, the jobs, and what is the job description of the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِ. He teaches them the recitation, tilawah. Okay? Without meaning, just the recitation in itself is an act of reward. And then Allah says, He purifies them, and then He says, وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابِ. And then He teaches them the meaning. So recitation of Allah, the Messenger of Allah teaches the recitation without meaning, and then He teaches the meaning as well. So even, and this is why the in the Quran, in the Hadith, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He said that the one letter you get 10 rewards, and He said, لا أقول ألف لام ميم حرف. ألف لام ميم is not one word. It's ألف حرف ولام حرف وميم حرف. 10 for ألف. When somebody reads ألف لام ميم, 30 rewards. 10 for ألف, 10 for la, and 10 for mim. We will not understand anything. There's no meaning for alif, la, mim. This is what we call huruf al-muqatta'at. Nobody knows the meanings of kaf, ha, ya, ayn, sad, ha, mim in the Quran. Taha, ma anzalna alayka al-Quran litashqa. Nobody knows the meanings. These are what we call huruf al-muqatta'at. The muqatta'at means it's been cut off. Qata, this means cut off. What do you mean? What's cut off? The meaning of this has been cut off from the ummah. Nobody knows of this meaning. Whether the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew of the meanings, there's two opinions amongst the scholars. Some scholars said he knew along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the other opinion of the scholars is that even the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not given the knowledge of huruf al-muqatta'at. So these, even though there are rewards, this clearly shows there are rewards even in reciting the book of Allah without understanding. But the other extreme, brother and sister, that we find, because sometimes when we put too much focus on that, then people go to the other extreme, where people are there who don't want to ever even, you know, think about wanting to understand the basic message of the Quran. Tadabbur means reflection, thinking, deliberation. To think about the words, to understand the message of the Quran. This book which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, a unique book, it's for us, it's not for anyone else. Allah did not send this book to the Christians and the Jews and the Hindus and the Sikhs, and not for the atheists. It's for us. If we spend a life of 60, 70 years, and we cannot take time out to understand even the meanings of Surah Al-Fatiha, which we recite on a daily basis, numerous times. I mean, there are a lot of people, I've met brothers who have no clue or idea what, you know, they are reading in Salah, what Surah Al-Fatiha means. That's the basic, at least, job and responsibility of a Muslim, to try to at least understand Surah Al-Fatiha and the few verses of the Quran that we recite in our prayer. When we say you get rewards without understanding, we shouldn't go too extreme in that that's it, we just make an oath that we don't want to understand the meanings, that's it. You get a reward, that's another extreme. Allah says in the Quran that كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ. This is a book that we've revealed to you, إِلَيْكَ, O Messenger, to you. مُبَارَكٌ, it's full of blessings. And then Allah says, لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِ, Surah Sa'. This is, we reveal to you the book so that they, the Muslims, they reflect, tadabbur. They reflect and ponder over the verses. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ Allah says in another place, don't they tadabbur, don't they reflect on the words of Allah, don't they reflect and ponder over the Qur'an? أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا Oh, is there a lock on their hearts? Allah is asking the question. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا Surah Muhammad. In another surah, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافٌ كَثِيرًا So, tafakkur, reflection. How do we do that? I mean, there are etiquettes, because this is the concentration, the khushu' that we have when we read the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a person is understanding, when he passes by a verse of rahmah, Allah's rahmah and Allah's mercy and Allah's blessings and Allah's ni'mah is being mentioned, then stand by it, stop for a moment. The one reciting should stop for a moment and think about the reading, think about the rahmah and mercy of Allah. Ask Allah, say, Allahumma inni as'aluka rahmah, Allahumma inni as'aluka rahmatak. Ask and seek the rahmah, the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ask Allah and make dua and supplicate to Allah to give you Jannah and Paradise. When Jannah is mentioned, ask Allah to give you Jannah. And then when the person reciting passes by a verse of adab and punishment, the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, we need to stop, we need to think, we need to reflect, we need to ponder. And then after that, if that punishment is regarding the non-Muslims, the disbelievers, then thank Allah again. Thank Allah, say Alhamdulillah, I am saved from this evil. And if that is regarding the Muslims, a sin which some Muslims are involved in, then look at your own self. Am I involved in this particular sin? If you are not, then again thank Allah. Alhamdulillah, الَّذِي أَنْقَذَنِي مِنْ هَذِي الْمَعْصِيَةِ The one who saved me from this evil or from this sin. And if you are involved in that sin, then straight away go and repent. And make a firm intention at that time that this particular sin that is being mentioned in the Qur'an right now, I will make a firm intention, a resolution that I will not commit the sin again. Seek the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise, if you, for example, there are so many verses in the Qur'an, what we call ayatul nida, Allah is addressing us. There are many places where Allah says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. O you who believe. So when Allah is saying, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, think for a moment, Allah is talking to us. Allah is saying, O you, if your name is Muhammad, think Allah is saying, O Muhammad, I'm talking to you. Abdullah, I'm talking to you. Allah is talking to the believers. So this is the reflection. And then stop, and then think after that. What is Allah saying? Okay, O Allah, I am here, I'm ready, I'm listening. Like some of the scholars used to actually stop there and say, Labbayka Rabbi wa sa'dik. They used to read, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, and then they used to say, Labbayka Rabbi wa sa'dik. Oh my Lord, I am here, I am present, tell me what you have to tell me. And then after that, the message that was given, they would look at it. What is the message? What is Allah saying? If it's a command, they would ensure that they carry out that command. If it's a prohibition, they would ensure they would stay away from that prohibition. Allah says, for example, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, qu anfusakum wa ahlikum naran, wa quduha an-nasu wal hijara. عَلَيْهَا مَلَائِكَةٌ غِلَابٌ شِدَادٌ لَا يَحْصُونَ اللَّهَ مَا أَمَرَ وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُمَرُونَ Allah says, oh you who believe, so you wait. And you say, رَبَّيْكَ رَبِّي وَسَعْلِيكَ And then Allah says, save your own self and your families from the fire of hell, the hellfire, whose fuel will be mankind and stones. So think, am I fulfilling this obligation, this duty of saving myself from the fire of hell? Am I fulfilling this responsibility of saving my family from the fire of hell? If you are not, then haste towards correcting that. And if you're a husband, then think about it. That am I looking after my family in terms of not just worldly aspects? We need to, but many of us are just concerned about looking after our families in a worldly aspect. What about the hereafter aspect? Am I doing enough to save them from the fire of hell? And it's not just the responsibility of the husband, it's anyone in the family. Sometimes it's the wife who's more practicing than the husband. It's her duty as well, responsibility. Sometimes the children are practicing more than the parents. It's not always the parents or it's not always the man or the husband. It's anyone looking after your family. But yes, indeed, the one who has authority over others, كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْئُولٌ عَنَ رَعَيَّتِهِ The ones below you, you have a superior responsibility and you'll be questioned about them. But this particular verse, Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Like that, Allah says, for example, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, tubu ila Allahi tawbatan nasuha. Repent to Allah with sincere repentance. So haste, go and repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are many verses, collect them all. No, I remember the Shaykh, Imam Zayd Shaker, I was in America a few years ago, and he gave a talk. We had a conference on the Qur'an, and you know, I gave a talk, and after my talk was his talk, he was calling America. And he said, I just recently gave a whole one-day course on Ya Ayyuhal Ladina Amanus of the Qur'an. All the Ya Ayyuhal Ladina Amanu in the Qur'an. I don't know how long, the full day or the half day, whatever. But a course on Ya Ayyuhal Ladina Amanu, all the verses in the Qur'an that start with Ya Ayyuhal Ladina Amanu, or you believe. What does Allah say after that? An explanation, a commentary on those verses. So this is the tafakkur, and this is the tadabbur. If there's a verse that talks about the previous nations, about the stories and history, about, you know, the Qawm Aad and the people of the prophets of, you know, like Yusuf and all the other Musa, alayhi salatu wasalam, then it's not just a story for us as an entertainment. The story of Yusuf, okay, it's very entertaining. It's not for entertainment. It's, we need to take lessons from them. We need to try to understand those stories and take heed, ibrah, from these stories. If, you know, there are verses that you don't, like ayat al-mutashabihat, huruf al-muqat'at, the meanings only known to Allah, then leave those to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is tafakkur, a great integral, reflection, tafakkur, tadabbur, thinking. And it's good to even repeat verses of the Quran. In terms of reflection, keep a small translation. It's not haram, it's not sinful. Yeah, it's not sinful. As I said, this is another extreme where people think that even trying to open or look at some meanings by itself is sinful. It's not. But indeed, do not transgress the limits, because there are people for every science. The scholars are there. It's the Quran. There are complicated verses in the Quran. There are simple verses in the Quran. When Allah says, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ, we have made the Quran easy, لِلذِّكْرِ, to take nasiha, to take advice, basic verses that talk about Allah's qudra, Allah's power, and they talk about Jannah and Jahannam, general verses. And Quran is generally mainly maw'idha and nasiha. That's for everyone to understand. You can pick up, and if you get slightly confused, don't understand, go to a scholar, go to your imam, go to a shaykh. Allah says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, ask the people of knowledge if you don't understand. But there are definitely other verses which are complicated verses, especially Ayatul Ahkam. There are approximately 500 verses of law. Those are complicated. You know, that's not for mere people like me and you that we just take out. Though, I mean, we can understand them, but for us to start interpreting them and deriving rules and extracting rules from them without any recourse to any shuyukh and ulama and scholars of study, under scholars all the way to the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that's not something we should be doing, because for every science, I mean any book you pick up, whether it's medical science, you can't just read it by yourself. But Quran, there are verses which are simple, like Surah Al-Fatiha. We're reading in Salah, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. When we read, if we understand the meanings, and there's tafakkur and tadabbur, reflection and pondering, so we'll read and we'll understand, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, the Imam's reading, we're thinking. We're not thinking about, this is the khushu' in prayer. When the imam is reciting Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, we are thinking, yes, all praise, Alhamdulillah, all meaning everything, all praise that exists in this world. Any praise for anyone. Anyone did something good, someone did something good in Manchester, in Cheadle here. Every praise that is there in the world, everything belongs to Allah. Because ultimately, it's through the tawfiq and the granting of Allah. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen is the Lord of mankind. Sometimes we don't even realize they're offering salah. It's like, Allah is quite a little kind of holy. Assalamu alaikum. Oh yeah, salah finished. That's like a, you know, automatic salah. You know, we have two types of prayers. One is an active life salah prayer. One is an automatic, just going through the motions. You've gone onto your plane and you just slept through it, and when you landed, wow, I've landed. That's a salah many of us, we don't even realize. The active, real life prayer is where there's tafakkur, there's tadabbur, there's khushu', there's concentration, there's realization that we are standing before our Creator, our Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rabbul Alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, we think about the rahmah of Allah, the mercy of Allah. Maliki yawmiddin, we think about Allah being the owner, the malik, the owner of the day of recompense. Iyaka, and then we're talking to Allah. We say, Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'in. Oh Allah, it is only you. If you know the meanings, Iyaka na'budu. Allah, it is only you whom we worship. It is only you from whom we seek help and assistance. And then we say, Ihdina sirat al-mustaqim. Oh Allah, guide us, not guide us, take us. The scholars have explained this, Ihdina ila sirat, Ihdina sirat. But not just guide us and show us where the right path is, but physically take us. and place us on the right path. All the verses like that, thinking and reflecting, tadabbur, repetition of the verses is quite good, so we understand the meaning. There's a particular verse that's having a deep impact on you, in a spiritual sense, on your heart. So you're repeating it. Say for example, somebody who loves the verse, you know, ihdina as-sirata al-mustaqim. So you keep on saying, ihdina as-sirata al-mustaqim, ihdina as-sirata al-mustaqim, 3-4 times. That's the quality recitation of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's, I mean, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you should repeat, there's a hadith where, you know, when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once stood in Qiyam al-Layl and he read the verse, إِن تُعَذِّبْهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ عِبَادُكَ وَإِن تَغْفَرْ لَهُمْ فَإِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. He kept on reciting that particular verse until morning, just one verse. قَامَ يُكَرِّرُهَا وَيُرَدِّرُهَا. He stood up and he kept on repeating it. It's good to cry. The ulama, Imam Anawi, mentions in his book again, one of the etiquettes is whilst reciting the book of Allah, at the time of recitation of the book of Allah, al-tabaki, cry al-buka'u, to cry, to shed some tears. Imam al-Ghazali, one of the great scholars of his ummah, also he states, al-buka'u mustahabul ma'al-qira'ah. It's actually recommended to cry and shed some tears when you read the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is actually based on the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the sunnah of Imam Abu Dawud. He says that iqra'ul qur'ana wabka. This is the hadith. That when you read Qur'an and cry, فَإِن لَمْ تَبْكُوا فَتَبَاكُوا. If you're not able to cry naturally, then just try, just do it, you know, just make it up. You know, if you can't do it naturally, if you can't cry naturally, Just get some onions and pray next to you. So this is for those people who can't cry naturally. Hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, some of the scholars used to talk, that it's a conversation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at-tajawub ma'al qira'ah. Like when Allah says something, so you respond. You're reading Surah al-Teen and you come to, you know, where Allah says, Alaysa Allahu bi ahkamil hakimin. Allah is asking the question, posing the question, and Allah is saying, isn't Allah أحكم الحاكمين, the ruler of all rulers? So it's recommended to say, yeah, bala, indeed you are the ruler of the rulers, the greatest ruler. وَأَنَا عَلَى ذَلِكَ مِنَ الشَّاهِدِينَ. And I am one of the witnesses to this fact. أليس سورة القيامة ends with, أليس الله بقادر على أن يحيي الموتى. Isn't Allah capable, doesn't Allah possess the power, the ability, the capability of creating you and resurrecting you after you die? So you say, bala, آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ. Indeed Allah, you have the power to resurrect us, and we will be resurrected. Also listening, this is just recitation, even listening to the book of Allah is greatly rewarded. It's spiritually, it's not just reciting. Reciting has more rewards, but even listening can have a spiritual impact on you. Listening to the book of Allah is sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's an act of ibadah, an act of reward. وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ, Surah Al-A'raf, Allah says, وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا. When the book of Allah, Qur'an, is being recited, فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ, listen to it attentively. أَنصِتُوا, remain quiet. It's actually sinful when someone's reading the book of Allah and we talk. Listen to it attentively. And do not talk, be silent, be quiet. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ, if you want the mercy of Allah. There's a hadith in the Sahih of Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, once he says, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to me, اقرأ عليّ, read the book of Allah to me. So he said, يا رسول الله, اقرأ عليك وعليك أنزل. How can I read the book to you, the Qur'an, when the Qur'an has been revealed unto you? He said, my place to read? So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنِّي أُحِبُّ أَنْ أَسْمَعَهُ مِنْ غَيْرِ. I would like to listen to, I desire to listen to the book of Allah from someone else. There's reward in listening. So he said, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, فَقَرَأْتُ سُورَةَ النِّسَاءِ. I started reading Surah Al-Nisa. And when I was reading, حَتَّى أَتَيْتُ إِلَى هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ, I recited the whole Surah Al-Nisa. When I came to the verse, فَكَيْفَ إِذَا جِئْنَا مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ بِشَهِيدٍ وَجِئْنَا بِكَ عَلَى هَؤُلَاءِ شَهِيدًا. He was reading and he came to this verse. That how would it be when we bring from every nation a witness, and we will bring you, Messenger, as a witness over all of these witnesses? Abdullah ibn Abbas said, when I came to this verse, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, حَسْبُكَ الْآنِ. It's enough, enough, that's it, I can't take it anymore. فَنَظَرْتُ إِلَيْهِ. I looked at the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَإِذَا عَيْنَاهُ تَذْرِفَانِ. His eyes were shedding tears. The companions radiallahu anhum, they used to actually tell, request one another, أَسْمِعْنَا يَا فُلَان. يَا فُلَان, oh such and such, come on. Let us hear some words of the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But remember, it was not just for, well, it wasn't for entertainment. It was not just for the good voice or the good sound. Indeed, having a good voice sound, it's a side thing, it's good, it's good. Iqra'ul Qur'ana, you know, biduhuni al-arq, and reciting the hadith that talk about reciting the book of Allah in a nice way, definitely, without a doubt. But it's not only that. If there's no earth, nothing else, you know, some of us, it's just like an entertainment. We love the entertainment of the recitation of the book of Allah. You know, and it's just, you know, the sound and the voice and that's it, whether there's tafakkur, tadabbur, reflection, we don't care. This recitation and this listening was not for entertainment. It was to take spiritual benefit from the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we can't read, we should try to listen. In our cars, more than nasheeds, we should have CDs of Qur'an. Unfortunately, every car we sit in, it's nasheed. We should try to have the, you know, Qur'anic recitation as much as possible. So these are some etiquettes, and I'm ending in just 5 more minutes, inshallah. That was the main area. Qur'an being, if we act upon these spiritual, these etiquettes and these rules and all these things that I've talked about, then Qur'an will be a cure for us spiritually. Number two and number three, just briefly, as I said, the main one is a spiritual cure. Number two, Qur'an is a spiritual cure for us in terms of, we said, cure for the spiritual cure and cure for the problems of the world, societal problems. Qur'an is a cure. You look at the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all the social problems that we have the problems in the society, whether the problems are at home, whether it's in the society or whether globally. You know, all the conflicts and all the troubles and all the friction that we have. I remember a couple of years ago, once I gave a talk here, family conflicts, causes and solutions, and alhamdulillah, had a lot of people came to that talk because it shows that, you know, this is something that is within our communities and societies. We have a lot of family problems. There's no better cure for us. And actually that talk, I extended it, and you know, in the past Ramadan that went in my city in Leicester, we have this radio, and I actually gave a whole 30-day Ramadan, every day an hour or so, a course on family disputes, causes and solution. And I went through like 10 causes and 10 solutions from in terms of family disputes. But global problems, social problems, the Qur'an is nothing but a cure. Look, just any verse, just pick up, you know, certain verses that talk about global problems, social problems within the house, just pick up. One surah of the Qur'an is enough to solve all our problems. Surah Al-Hujarat. One surah of the Qur'an. Surah Al-Hujarat, Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِن جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَئٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. Oh, you who believe, when a sinful person comes to you with some information, some news, then فَتَبَيَّنُوا. Verify the authenticity of this report. And تُصِيبُ قَوْمٌ بِجَهَالَةٍ. Because you might do something out of ignorance to someone, فَتُصْبِحُ عَلَى مَفْعَلْتُ النَّادِمِينَ. And then you realize and you become regretful of what you did later on. This verse, if we just act upon it, anyone said he said this, you know, somebody comes and tells you, she said this, or he said this, or she said this, or he said this, verify it. And then verses after that, Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِّ. All you who believe, avoid suspicion. Don't suspect people. Don't look at someone and start suspecting people of doing wrong things or sinful things or harmful things. And then the next verse Allah says, وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا. Don't be a spy. Don't go and search and investigate into the ills of the people. وَلَا يَغْتَ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا. Do not backbite. These are all solutions and cures for the societal problems that we have. And globally as well, justice. The Qur'an teaches nothing but justice. The Qur'an is full of justice. You know, our whole deen and Islam is based on justice for Muslims and non-Muslims. Actually, there's a verse in the Quran, you know, I think in Surah Al-Hadid, Allah says that وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلَنَا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ. We have sent the messengers with the signs, وَأَنزَلْنَا مَعَهُمُ الْكِتَابِ. And we have sent the book with them. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent with the book, Al-Quran. Why? Allah says, لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ. The whole purpose, objective, aim, goal, motive behind sending a messenger with a book is so that the whole of humanity establish justice. There's justice in the world. Our deen revolves around justice. In Allah, ya'muru bil adl. There's nothing but justice. You know, even our basic aqidah of tawheed, we all know how important tawheed is, right? That is also based on justice. Shirk is inna shirka la dhulmun azeem. It's the greatest of oppression. Tawheed, because you know, if we associate partners with Allah, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the greatest of sins is an taj'ala lillahi niddan wa huwa khalaqa. That you create, associate partners with Allah, whereas Allah is the one who's created you. You're being unjust to Allah. He creates you and you say to him, that, oh Allah, okay, you're my God, but there's another one as well. That's injustice. Even tawheed is based on justice. All the problems, all the oppression will be solved in the world if we take the Qur'an, number two, cure for societal problems, global problems. And lastly, as I said, the ulama have said, the first two areas are the main two areas where the Qur'an is a cure. Cure for spiritual diseases, a spiritual cure, and cure for the societal problems. Yeah? Clear? Everybody understood these two? Just 2 minutes, brother. The last part, Qur'an is a cure in a physical sense as well, but this is something limited, it's on the side. Without a doubt, it's documented, it's proven, it's in the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But unfortunately, our communities, if we talk about the Qur'an being a cure, or if we deal with the Qur'an being a cure, or if we look at it, or we try to understand the Qur'an, or if we want the Qur'an to be a cure for us, then we probably just take it as a cure physically, that's it. Someone's ill, say, okay, it's just you know. It is definitely a cure, I'm not disregarding this fact. But primarily the Qur'an is a spiritual cure and a cure for the social world problems. But yes, it is min al-amrad al-dahira, from physical ailments, maladies. There's a famous hadith of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, when the companions all went on an expedition. They went to a community, a tribe. The leader, Sayyid al-Qawm, the leader of that tribe, a scorpion bit him and he had a poison or something. So they came to ask for a cure. And the Sayyidina Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu said, I know a cure. He read Surah al-Fatiha. Surah al-Fatiha, another name for it is Surah al-Shafiya. But actually there's about 7-8 names. Surah al-Kafiya and Surah al-Shafiya and some other names. But it's a cure. He recited Surah al-Fatiha, he blew on him, ruqya. And he was cured. They came back to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they informed him. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam smiled and said, how do you know that this was a cure? The Qur'an, and there's another hadith where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, somebody came and said, Ya Rasulullah, Messenger of Allah, I have a throat infection. He said, read Surah al-Fatiha. It is a cure, without a doubt. I mean, this is the reason why the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before retiring to bed, he would recite the mu'awwadhatayn, qul a'udhu bi rabbil falaq, qul a'udhu bi rabbin nas, the two last surahs of the Qur'an, blow in his hands and wipe his whole body. This is a sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Qur'an, without doubt, is a cure for physical maladies as well. But primarily, before it being a cure for physical maladies, it is a cure for spiritual diseases, and it's a cure for the problems of the society.
JazakAllah khair for listening. I'll call you for the other one. Astaghfirullah wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.